Hi, I'm Sid, co-founder and CEO at GitLab. And today I'm together with Raj, who's a professor at Harvard Business School. And he's written a great article about remote work. So we're going to talk about that article and his insights today. And he might ask me some questions. And Raj, before we proceed, can you maybe introduce yourself and give a bit of background?
Sure. Thank you, Sid. So my name is Raj Choudhury. I'm an associate professor at the Harvard Business School. And my research really looks at geographic mobility, but also immobility, you know, the reasons people do not move when there are economic incentives to move. And in that context, what I've been really interested in the recent past is to study this new form of remote work, which I call work from anywhere, which goes beyond the traditional working from home model in allowing people to choose the geographic location they want to live in. And what I argue in my academic paper is that this form of remote work not only gives you the flexibility with respect to how you spend your time, but it also gives you the flexibility to choose where you live in. And so, for instance, you could move to a lower cost of living location. You could move back to where your family is from. It could help resolve dual career issues and so on and so forth. So this is the agenda that I really want to study going ahead. I, of course, understand this may not work in every organization or every kind of task. And that's why I'm having all these conversations with companies and managers and CEOs, just to educate myself as well in terms of what are the business model innovations going on around work practice.
Awesome. Thanks so much. And thanks for joining us and being in this broadcast. I'm with you. I fully believe this is like the future. We call it all remote. And that's like the company doesn't have some offices. It's not that you could work remote some of the time. No, everyone is remote and you're remote all the time. What has driven your interest in researching the impact and expansion of remote work? Why did you get interested in this?
That's a great question, Sid. So my personal intellectual journey has been, so prior to academia, I was a consultant with McKinsey for many years. So I was remote all the time. And then I was running a business for Microsoft in Asia, where I was traveling all the time back to Redmond. And so when I got into academia, really, I started researching geographic mobility because I saw the immense benefits that moving people around had for multinational firms. But then in the middle of that exploration, I also realized that people do not move all that often. And there are many reasons why they do not move. And academically, I call that framework a framework of mobility frictions. So they could be regulatory reasons related to visas. They could be family reasons. They could be personal reasons. I want to be close to my hometown or aging parents. They could be economic reasons that I don't want to move to Silicon Valley because it's so like expensive to get a place to live there. So if you believe the two things that I believe, that moving people around is productivity enhancing, but there are frictions at all levels in moving people around, I guess the question then becomes, how do you solve this problem of frictions? And I see working from anywhere as one of the plausible solutions. So if you cannot hire an engineer because that person would not get an H-1B visa, could you put that person in Vancouver and make that person work into Silicon Valley remotely? So that is how my interest in this topic progressed. And what I'm now exploring, Sid, is when does this work? What kind of jobs does it work for? And what are the boundary conditions? So when does it not work? And I'm at the, I want to say like at the beginnings of my exploration. So I'm also here to learn from you guys and from like this discussion.
Cool. And I can't help but giving my quick take on that. I don't think that there's a benefit in moving people around per se. I do think there's a benefit of interaction across many a diversity of background. You don't necessarily have to move yourself. I think where you live should be, it has a big impact on your family. If you move like 10 times during your childhood, that tends to be not a great thing. And there's like family to care for, there's aging parents to take care of. There's people who just want to live somewhere because they want to explore that. A lot of people at GitLab have that too. And of course, there are spouses who are bound to a certain place. So if you deal with something in the physical world, and that can be anything from a hospital to a hardware manufacturing, it doesn't make sense to be all remote. It makes sense to gather around those atoms. But more and more companies are don't need any physical manifestation. Like everything, their inputs and their outputs are completely digitized. And I think for all those companies, it could work. I do think you have to accommodate remote. It's not like, just like when you're co-located, you take care of an office and you do things like that. If you're all remote, you have to like be intentional about the informal communication that happens in the company.
So just building on that, so I'm completely with you. And so I'm a big advocate for this. So don't get me wrong. So I'm the context that we studied in that academic paper and that I wrote about in the Harvard Business Review was the United States Patent Office.
Uh-huh.
And the reason they thought about this work from anywhere kind of policy in that organization was it's very expensive to get real estate in Alexandria, Virginia. So they were motivated by real estate savings. But what we did is we conducted this really detailed examination of what happens when people move from Alexandria to like now Florida or Texas or anywhere in the country. And, you know, given that you're always concerned about whether the productivity effect you find is a correlational result or is it a causal result, we exploit what we call this natural experiment that helps us identify causal results. And I can talk more about the experiment if you're interested, but we find that productivity goes up 4.4% when you move from a traditional work from home program where you had to still come into Alexandria one day a week from that setting to this work from anywhere setting. And what we argue in the paper is that this really works for them because of two reasons. Because first, the job of the patent examiner is a very independent job. You're not working in a large team, but just examining a single patent over like two or three years. And the second thing that worked for them was people had to first spend 2 years in the office before they went to the work from home program, and then they could move to this work from anywhere program. And so what that does is it takes care of the fact that you have a social network in the office, you know who to call when you have a problem. So here's a question for you, Sid. So in a setting where you are working in a team, or in a setting where you're bringing on someone new to the company, have you thought about how you resolve the coordination costs and the learning costs, as I call them, if you are always remote from the beginning?
Yeah, I think, so to solve for kind of learning, there's a lot of things you learn implicitly at an office that we have to be explicit about. And that's why we have a company handbook of over 3,000 pages where we describe every process and also like who works on what. Like a really big part of it is like being able to find the right person. So we have a team page, it's even public, everyone's listed. We have a, if you Google GitLab categories, you'll find a very extensive page of all the different parts of our product. Who's the product manager for that? Who's the UX person for that, et cetera. So we do a really good job of detailing what people are experts at. So you know who to reach out to. So you don't need to be at the office to find that out. And that's by the way, that's a super inefficient method, because like it's not that people are at the office and they naturally discover this. No, they have to tap people on the shoulder, like who works on this, who works on that. And our policy is just write it down. People have a nickname, great, write it down. You don't have to be at the office to find out. And then regarding independence, obviously, like you're most, if you're completely can work independently, that works well. But I think at GitLab, we've managed to do very collaborative tasks well remote. And two values at GitLab help with that. One of them is transparency. So we all work in the same issue tracker. Everything is visible to everyone. And the second thing is iteration. And iteration means scoping down tasks so you can complete them faster and doing many iterations quickly. Mm-hmm. And by scoping them down, you need to coordinate with fewer people. And when we work together, for example, our front end and back end teams are completing something, they do have a video call together to kind of split up the work for the next 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. But they don't have a project manager kind of doing that for them. There's a huge degree of individual responsibility. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned real estate savings. I think the savings are not just the office costs, but an ability to hire from a much larger pool.
Yeah.
The productivity that you have when you cannot be shoulder tapped, like when you are in control of your working environment and how you plan your time, the happiness and balance that comes from not saving time on the commute time and divorce rate are correlated, and the ability to kind of not have to churn out of the company when you need to move someplace else or your spouse or something like that.
Sure.
So better retention.
So just to add to that, let me just add a couple of interesting findings from the setting that I studied.
Please.
So we found that people on average moved to a lower cost of living location. And we estimated that the US Patent Office did not reduce the salary because you were signing up for this program. So the net income increase was actually 3%, which is not insignificant. So this is real money in your pocket. The second thing we found is that there are very interesting patterns, just give me 1 second, of where people move to. So just to give you one example, we found this cluster of people who moved from Alexandria, Virginia to Florida. And when we looked at the characteristics of these people, we found that they were typically older, more tenured people. And I've thought about this result and I like it a lot because I think if you think about the aging workforce problem we have, if working from anywhere could extend the productive life of our workers by even a few years, and they are as productive or even more productive if they move to Florida or retirement locations, then that could be a really, really important way to sort of boost the productivity, not only for companies, but for the economy as a whole. On the flip side, so once again, I'm a huge proponent of this policy, but I'm also thinking about all the possible boundary conditions. So when I talked to, today morning, I was talking to a CEO who has run this really large electronics company. And the gentleman said, Raj, maybe it's I'm old, but my bias is this model will fail for one reason, and that's water cooler conversations. When you are in the same location, you are, and especially when you are a CX or innovation driven person, you get these spontaneous conversations in the parking lot or in the water cooler or at the end of a meeting or the beginning of a meeting. And that had me thinking whether an all remote model can find some alternative solutions to stimulate these spontaneous conversations.
Yeah, I appeal to that earlier. Like people take a lot of time designing their office and everything, like they rent a parking lot, everything. Just put a tenth of that energy in facilitating informal communications. At GitLab, we're super intentional about that. Mm. Every day we have a group conversation about a certain aspect of the company. There's a big slide deck. They don't present anything, just Q&A from everyone. So lots of great ideas follow from that.
Interesting.
Every day we have a breakout call, 20 minutes with a group of team members from all across the company, kind of a fixed group of people. And today the question we were asked was, what's your favorite purchase you made in the last year?
Interesting.
And I saw some great paint by numbers paintings by some team members, not all of them finished. And I actually gifted someone a USB coffee mug. Anyway, just informal communication. We also do coffee chats where you plan 25 minutes with a team member just to hang out together. No agenda, can be talking about work, can be about private life, but it's not weird to put that on someone's agenda. And we people who join the company, we have them do that a few times. Mm-hmm. And the last thing we do is group socials. Mm. So every week you hang out for 50 minutes with the rest of your team. And you just, there's no agenda. You mostly talk about life outside of work. And some people have a beverage as well while they do that. Mm. So there's lots of ways to do this. And making people commute for 90 minutes, in addition to the time it takes to do the water cooler talk, is sure. one of the most inefficient ways to do this. And it's ridiculous that people feel, well, it's not ridiculous. People feel uncomfortable kind of organizing this. But as we know, like if you organize something, you tend to get better results. Mm-hmm. And why depend on randomness for that? I know at Pixar, they place the restroom centrally so people would bump into each other. Mm. Yes, okay, these are good ideas, but why not step it up a notch and actually organize the informal communication? And we do this. We have a lot of things we do also to have people meet in real life. Mm. I think it can be stimulated. It's working out, and you still save all the commute time because... Yeah. Look, you want informal communications. You don't want people sitting in the car by themselves.
Sure, sure. And just to add a couple of thoughts to that, Sid, so I think that's an excellent point. And I would love to talk more to you about this offline. So the other thing that I thought about is, so two more thoughts to add. I found in the US Patent Office context that people were forming these informal communities of practice. So let me explain what I mean by that. So you were no longer mandated to live in Alexandria, Virginia. So you moved somewhere. But if you had people from your same technology group, what they call the art unit in the patent office, within the 25-mile radius of where you lived, we actually found an even more disproportionate higher productivity increase. So the average increase was 4%, 4.4. But if you had someone from your art unit living within 25 miles of where you are now living, you had even a higher productivity increase. And then we are still digging this, but at least anecdotally, what one group of examiners have told me is that they now have these water cooler conversations, but on a golf course. So they have informally found, and this is completely based on individuals seeking out, they've informally formed these informal communities, and they meet once a week or once in 2 weeks, play golf together, but also talk about work. The larger question I have, and it's a question for you. So I've done some research with very large multinational companies like Microsoft. And one of the things that seems to work in those contexts where people are spread out across China, India, Israel, Redmond, is temporary co-location. That you don't need to move people permanently. You go to Redmond from India for 3 weeks. Or you create these temporary events where developers on the same technology all come together. They do API compatibility testing, but they're also going out for beer. They're getting to know each other much better. And when they disperse, they still retain that social connection. Have you guys thought about bringing people temporarily together physically? Or do you think in your model, even that is not required?
Yeah, for sure. And we do a couple of things. So one thing is we do the local meetups. So if there's multiple GitLab in your area, there tends to be a local meetup every now and then. Once a month, just go to a co-working space together, have dinner afterwards. Yeah. We have a travel stipend. So if you're visiting other GitLab team members around the world, we partially reimburse you for the travel expense that costs. Yeah. We also bring the entire company together for a week every 9 to 12 months. Mm. And then we don't do work because it's a super expensive thing to do. So we focus on the informal part. So what we do is we do excursions together. We tend to go to an interesting place and we have an unconference where we talk about things proposed by individual team members in small groups, kind of informal communication. So we do the things that being in person is best suited to. Mm. And I think that works really well. And then also we do throughout the year, we do a lot of like video calling and you can watch our YouTube channel. Like we do bring people together and I think there's something to in-person that is special. And we do stimulate that in multiple ways. But we don't want to rely on that for work. And we don't need it for work. We need it because it gives a feeling of belonging and it helps to get to know people but it's not a necessity.
So let me ask you this, Sid. So of the multiple
reasons... To any board members watching, it is a necessity, and it's 4.5 million. So thanks for that. But right. we do invest there. So it's not needed per se, but we do believe in the incremental returns of that.
Mm. Well, that's very interesting. So just one question that I had for you was, of all the reasons that I can think of that I've documented in my research, the problems with visas, the dual careers, the what prompted you to first of all, come up with this model? So real estate savings, or, you know, what was the first reason you thought about this model of work?
Yeah, like most good things at GitLab, it kind of was other people's ideas. Basically, people stopped showing up at work. I started with the first team member in Serbia and my co-founder in the Ukraine. So we're remote by default. I hired some people in the Netherlands. They came to my place. I had two desks for a couple of days, and then they kind of stopped showing up, and I never met them, and they just worked from home. And after we graduated from Y Combinator, they told us, oh, you should get an office because this remote thing only works for engineering. So we got an office. And then all the executives I hired were like, oh, it's not going to work for my function. So I need people here. I'm like, great. We bought a lot of desks. So we're ready. And then, everyone kind of stopped showing up after a couple of days just because they were not missing out on any information. They were not missing out on career opportunities or gossip or contacts. And I don't think people come to the office because they like commuting. They come to the office because they don't want to be a second class citizen.
Right.
But if you make sure they're not missing out, they don't necessarily want to commute to the office.
And one thing I've thought about, and you know, something you said triggered that, is it important that the CXOs signal this behavior? Because you know, if the CXOs are always in one single office, then if I'm a middle manager and if I'm not in that office, I might feel I'm missing out or I'm a second class.
Exactly. And we had that dynamic even with our board meeting. Like if there's people in person, like the rest wants to be there as well. Also because hybrid calls where some people are like on a shared video camera are just really horrible. Anyway, we don't have that. People sometimes suspect I house some executives in my house. So we have Beamy here, a telepresence robot where everyone can log in, drive around my living room, and they see that only the CEO shadows. Today, Danielle and Eric are here. But we don't, like executives don't congregate. And that's so important because if you don't do that, then as executives, you're going to adapt to remote working practices. You're going to have things in public channels and chat. You're going to use GitLab issues. You're going to use Google Docs. You're going to have recorded meetings that you can easily live stream. Every single person needs to adopt those practices. And it's so much easier to do it with the whole company. And a lot of companies that are hybrid remote really struggle because like part of the company depends on all those, depends on it. They basically don't have the discipline to record and write down things. Then all the remote workers feel like they're missing, or they're not feel like, they actually miss out on information that's essential to do their job well.
May I chime in on that, Sid? Do you mind? And so for those viewing, I joined GitLab earlier this year to curate and lead and amplify the all remote message at GitLab. But for the past decade, I've worked in remote environments of all types. And this is the first time that I've worked in an environment where it's all remote. And I'll say from the employee perspective, having the CXOs also be remote, it sends an incredibly clear message that you're not going to miss out on potential praise and promotion and opportunity because you're not in the office. It just removes that barrier altogether. And when I've worked in other situations where there was at least one headquarters that some of the higher profile executives commuted into, as a remote worker, you definitely wondered if that lack of face time would impact you in some way. And so to relieve that mental burden, it massively helps morale as well as productivity in what I've seen.
That's fascinating. One thing to think about here is, it seems like you guys have really subscribed to this model. And by the way, I totally agree with what both of you guys said. And in our research, we actually find empirical evidence of that. So we compared the productivity of people in three stages. The first stage was when they were in office. The second stage was this traditional work from home, where they were 4 days of the week somewhere else, but they had to come back on a Friday to Alexandria, Virginia. And the third way was when they were completely cut off, like they could be anywhere. And we find that the productivity gain was much higher in the final step. So what we argue in the paper is what we call cut the umbilical cord. You know, this piecemeal remote thing doesn't work, or it doesn't work as effectively as this complete flexibility.
Yeah, close the office.
Yeah. So let me ask you this, Sid. So it seems you're really subscribed to this model. Is there, as a CEO, do you still have any sort of strategy question around this? Like any unresolved question around this model? Or do you think it's something you've perfected?
I think that it requires a lot of discipline. And every single day, we pay attention that people do it in the way we prescribe. For example, handbook first is a really hard one. People tend to send emails like, oh, this is now like this, or give a presentation, this is now like this. No, you should change it in the handbook. That's the way we keep kind of the documentation up to date so that everyone can rely on that for how to work together. That's, you should do that too in another company, but for us, it's essential. And that's a daily struggle. The other thing is, it used to be that the investors didn't believe in that. Now the investors are on the other side, where they're actively looking for more old remote companies because it's they have lower costs and they can hire people. They can hire better people.
That's right. No, I totally agree. So let me ask you this slightly differently. Do you think this is scalable? So I wonder how many employees you have right now. And do you think, is this like infinitely scalable, or is there like a sort of like inflection point beyond a certain size?
Yeah. So I think it scales better than the other model. So it's not that we have to defend like, oh, does this scale? No, like I see that a team in one room works really well. A team on one floor probably works okay. Team on multiple floors, you start having some problems. Team in multiple offices, getting harder. Team in multiple cities, getting harder. Team in multiple continents, getting super hard. That model breaks down. There's very little benefit to co-location if you're such a big company. Well, the benefits of remote, writing down your processes, stimulating cross-company informal communication, those get much more pronounced at scale. So it's not just that this scales, it scales way better.
Right. And that's very interesting, because in my world, there was a seminal research by Allen at MIT, which showed how the communication patterns between individuals broke down if there was a wall between them. So even the same floor or a staircase between them. So I think the point you're making is really well taken, that even if I'm physically in one location, it's not that there are no coordination costs. So that's a really interesting point. So I guess, you know, I would love to keep this conversation going and talk to you offline. But do you have any questions right now for this live stream? Other thoughts or questions?
Yeah. Do you think that all remote can help to kind of help be part of the solution in cost of living, traffic, and housing crises that we have in the Bay Area, and spreading opportunity more equally around the globe?
I think it's definitely something we should take very, very seriously. And it's for all of these reasons that you mentioned, but also because of the immigration situation, right? You know, I can't tell you how many anecdotes of, you know, students and friends I hear these days who cannot get a U.S. visa or are worried what's going to happen if Brexit really happens without a deal. Where should I go? And I think for all the reasons that regulation, all the uncertainty that regulation creates, and all the reasons that people, you know, have on a personal or a family, you know, dimension, I think this is something that we should really, really take seriously. And we should keep, as academics, I'm going to keep pushing this. So one thing I'll mention, I'm doing the study of a very large multinational. And what we find is that one of the the sort of frictions that is very hard to circumvent is temporal frictions. So if you're not in the same time zone, it's very hard to at least stimulate some of these even informal or spontaneous communication. So if you're not like, it's very hard for people to sort of wake up in the middle of the night and get them to do informal. So I was thinking maybe as you scale globally, so one of the insights of that piece of research, which I can talk about more if you're interested, is there was much more communication if you were in the same time zone, which probably implies that Silicon Valley should look more closely to Vancouver rather than to any location east or west. So it's easier to do these communication patterns north-south than east-west. But I think there are, of course, many wrinkles that will come up along the way. So one thing I've thought about, and I'm glad you mentioned this, was can the CX community start doing this as a signaling device for middle managers? But also, then you potentially, you are able to put your COO in the location, in a different location than the CFO based on actual market needs. So I know Cisco, for instance, put their CEO at one point in Bangalore. And my recollection is the CFO was sitting in Europe and the CEO, of course, continued to stay in the US. So I think this is a really interesting trend in work from my perspective. We need to understand it better. We need to have more success stories. We need to write about it. And, you know, I'm really glad that you guys are actively living this this model.
Cool. Yeah. And time zones are the bane of our existence. They make everything much harder. So a lot of our values, like transparency and iteration, they help to work asynchronously because that's what's needed to overcome time zones. It's not waking up in the middle of the night.
Right.
And Darren, you might want to write this up on our pages. I think the scaling conversation we had earlier is interesting, but I also think that maybe we should talk about the stages of remote working. You have companies with no remote. We have companies where remote is kind of allowed, like you can work some days from home. You have companies that allow some people to work remote all the time. They have companies that are completely remote, but coordinate across to one time zone. And Envision is an example of that, where they mostly keep Eastern time. And then you have companies that try to work asynchronously across many, many time zones. And I think that's a sliding scale. And I think what we're seeing at GitLab, we're attracting a lot of people that worked at companies where they were allowed to work remote full time, but where it was a hybrid remote organization. And those people tend to be second class citizens and flock to an all remote organization. And then asynchronous is the hardest, and we haven't totally nailed that. Our workers in Asia Pacific are not getting as good of an experience as the people in Europe and the Americas, and we're continually kind of trying to make that better and to do more asynchronously. So I think that will be interesting, and I hope you can use that differentiation in your research between the different types of remote working, because I think there's a big difference between a company like WordPress, where the management doesn't even have an office, and a company like GitHub, where all the senior leadership is co-located.
So no, I think we are thinking about the same question, Sid. Really happy we had this conversation. And I would love to talk to you offline. So maybe we can set up something and I can come over and meet you in person.
Let's stay in this call. Just to close the call, thanks so much for taking the time. Thanks for studying this. I think it's a huge benefit to the world.
Sure.